All right, we got one more guest, one more segment here for this December 10th edition of the show. That is Greg Peterson of VSiN, also the Hoopin' with Hoops podcast at GUnit_81 on Twitter. Greg, how's it going today, man?
Doing good. How about you?
Doing very well, buddy. Appreciate your time here. Thank you for joining us. Your debut here on Bang the Book Radio. I've done your MLB show a couple of times and your college basketball show once, I believe. But good to get you on my program here and turn the tables a little bit.
Good to be on with you because, yeah, you've been on my podcast a few times. Hooping with Hoops, a newly rebranded show, MLB Overtime, and VSiN as well. I remember we had you in studio a few months ago. That was a lot of fun. So maybe I need to visit your neck of the woods one of these days. Watch like a Cleveland State versus Northern Kentucky Rising League game. That would be right up my alley.
Yeah, I was going to say, you might want to pick a different time of year to come out here in the wintertime, but obviously, you know, with college basketball, there really is no optimal time to go to a cold weather city, as you know, because you're from Wisconsin, right?
Oh, yeah, for sure. And I am a man that I was born and raised in Wisconsin, so believe me, out there in the state of Ohio, it is nothing compared to me. I remember being a guy when I was at UW Oshkosh, a D3 university just in the middle of nowheresville, walking to school in negative 50 wind chills in January. That was unpleasant.
Yeah, so that's why you moved to Vegas, right? Get away from that.
Yeah, that and the fact that Vegas is a 24/7 community, and in Wisconsin, well, everything would shut down at like 5 p.m. because it was a bunch of party poopers.
Well, speaking of a 24/7 town, I mean, you're a 24/7 handicapper when it comes to college basketball as well as Major League Baseball, but in particular on the college basketball side. And incredibly enough, there may be some people that listen to my show that aren't aware of you or aware of the work that you do. You play an extremely high volume style. So explain to us what exactly that means and how that kind of became a thing for you.
What it means is that I really specialize in just pretty much betting the board in the sports that I do. But I specialize in the sports because with so many handicappers, you got a lot of guys that they'll dabble with a couple of hockey plays. They'll do some NBA. You'll do some college basketball. List goes on and on. I'm one of those people, when it comes to what I know best, I just fire big on all those games. Not necessarily in regards to my unit size, but I fire big in regards to the amount of games that I play. Because what I find is that when you play all these games, it really takes some luck out of it. We hear so much about bad beats and everything like that, and you're going to suffer them. But when you play a high-volume style, which I like to call, I guess you could call it the shotgun style, you really do a good job of being able to limit the variance. Because if you play like 2,000 games, it's like, oh, I got unlucky in this 2,000-game sample. You've got nobody to blame but yourself. But what I do is I pretty much play the side in total in every college basketball game, all these MLB games when that's in season, all the NFL, but I don't mess with anything else. I don't mess with the NBA. I don't mess with the NHL. I don't veer into college football. Heck, don't even get me started on trying to handicap like hockey or soccer or something like that. I am like a single sport specialist when it comes to that time of the year.
So how do you get to that decision? How do you decide, you know, I'm just going to play every game? You know, because a lot of people, again, maybe they'll play, you know, on a college basketball Saturday, 10 or 15 games. And like you said, that is subject to a lot of variance. But how do you wind up getting to a point where you go, you know, there's 150 games on Saturday, I'm going to play every one of them?
What has really been impactful for me is the fact that whenever I was doing plays early on, I would always find that, wow, the plays that I didn't take were the ones that always hit, and the plays that I did take, those are the ones that always stunk. I don't know how, I don't know why, but I would always, back when I was on my early days and giving out Twitter plays, I would have like leans and I would have plays. The plays would seemingly every day go like 2-3, 3-2, something like that. It's like, and my leans went 5-0. So I expanded a little bit more, found that I had a little bit more success with that. And then I found that the leans on top of that were still doing better than those plays. So then it went on and on, because what really struck me is the fact that I found that I really do a better job of just being able to handicap the landscape as a whole rather than just trying to focus on a couple individual games. Because back when I used to do college basketball coverage before I wound up moving to Las Vegas, which was about 2.5 years ago, I actually did college basketball bracketology. with college basketball bracketology, what you're having to do is you're having to research, okay, how does this Eastern Tennessee State win over Kansas not just affect Eastern Tennessee State over Kansas, but the opponents that they played, the opponents of those opponents? You get into, like, back in the day, RPI, strength of schedule, all those little metrics. And I look at college basketball as a big, giant web and how it's all interwoven, rather than the fact that, okay, it just impacts this Eastern Tennessee State squad. And with what I do with college basketball as well, is I always try to take a look at the landscape rather than trying to zone out a couple little things. So that's really how I got into it, because what I found is that the only time I really lost money when I was betting was when I was playing a very few and select amount of games. The more I expanded the amount of plays I had, the better I wound up doing, which is typically the exact opposite of so many other people. But it really is, because you have so many handicappers that they're zoning in on the MAC, they're zoning in on the Sun Belt. I'm zoning in on all 353 teams.
Well, I mean, I could be wrong here, but in my mind, as somebody who's, you know, a very selective type of handicapper, I don't play a large volume. I sit here and I think, okay, you cannot possibly have an edge on every single one of those games. I mean, are you using your own numbers? Do you refer to other resources, you know, like a KenPom, like a Bart Torvik? Do you talk with, you know, friends and peers, or do you just, you know, trusting all of your own handiwork?
I just trust everything based on my own handiwork, because when you take a look at KenPom, the reason why I don't use it is because if you notice college basketball openers, they pretty much copy the KenPom number. When you take a look at KenPom, it'll have like projected score of Creighton versus San Diego State, 70.5 to 64 in favor of San Diego State. Line opens up San Diego State laying 6, a total of like 133.5. And it's like, all right, where's the edge here? There's really none whatsoever. But when you really have to deep dive, that's where I find the biggest edge. Because when I have most of my good when I have most of my best calls, I guess you could say, it's typically on games that not even I'm necessarily sure of. But what I find typically is that the book is putting out there what I would call a generic line. Whenever you see the book put out there something like so-and-so laying 3 points, total right in the middle of where you typically have a college basketball game, like 138, 140 or something like that, that sort of tells me that, hey, even though I might not have the biggest edge on this game before I do my full in-depth research, book likely doesn't know a whole lot about these teams either. And by keeping up with so many smaller conferences, like the Northeastern Conference, like the SWAC, like the MEAC, you're able to gain a little bit of an advantage, because with the book, they're focused on the ACC, they're focused on the Big Ten, the Big East, because everyone is betting them. You don't see a whole lot of public bettors being like, oh, I would like $300 on this Bryant versus St. Francis of Brooklyn game or something of that nature. And that's where you could really have your advantage, because I still keep up with the ACC. I keep up with the Big East. I'm making sure that I'm aware of all the injuries. I'm making sure that I'm doing my preseason research. And that's part of it, too. With bookmakers, they all are making the same lines for college basketball, NFL, college football. You're not getting like 100 million billion different bookmakers that are making the lines for just every individual sport. They're making the lines for the same sport. So if you really hone in before the season, like I wrote the Vegas Sensitive Information Network's college basketball betting guide, breaking down all 353 teams, that's more research than just about anyone else is putting in there. And I've already talked to bookmakers that sometimes they're a little bit behind on their research. They're not looking at college basketball in June trying to make power rankings. They're rather focused on making their power rankings for the NFL, college football, and baseball.
Well, that had to be a great development for you over the summer then, when, you know, those added games or those extra games, some places would have them, some places wouldn't. Some teams wouldn't even be lined until they got to either conference tournaments or, you know, the teams that made the NCAA tournament. But now with all the games on the board, I mean, you've got to be thrilled since you're actually taking the time to look at the SWAC or the Southland or the Northeast or the Patriot League, something like that. I mean, that's right up your alley now.
Absolutely. These are some of the things that I absolutely love. And I actually, you mentioned the Patriot League. My favorite major back in the day was the Bucknell Bison, because the reason why I got into this is because back in 2005, Bucknell was playing a team called Kansas in the NCAA tournament. Now, who was Kansas supposed to play in the next round? Wisconsin. I was filling out my mom's college basketball bracket, and I thought, I don't want Wisconsin to have to play Kansas. I like this Bucknell team, so I put them down on my bracket. I wound up having a really, really good bracket as a result because I wanted Wisconsin to have all the easy games. I thought that they would run out of steam by the time the Elite Eight came because that was Wisconsin back in the day. The reason why they only played four holes, the only reason why they only played a couple holes of golf is because they couldn't find the final four. But it was one of those things where I just really got into this because I love those mid-major games. There are so few people that they pay attention to these games. You've noticed that the SWAC, the MEAC, they only get a couple games on like CBS Sports Network, ESPN on a yearly basis. Now, I will say with ESPN Plus as well, it makes it so much easier to be able to spot these games as well. Question is, who's watching some of these games? The answer is a lot of these guys like us that are handicapping them. I just still think that the bookmakers haven't necessarily caught up on some of these smaller conferences because they're still focused on Duke, North Carolina, which I was alluding to earlier, because that's where the money's coming in. You're noticing that they're going to take a small loss on a school like St. Francis of Brooklyn, whereas in return, they're going to focus on making their money on these bigger schools.
Now, to circle back to the finding edges thing, I mean, you know, you said you use your own numbers, and I mean, that obviously makes sense because if you're putting in the time and you trust your numbers, why wouldn't you use them? Do you ever deviate and go against your numbers? I mean, do you have time to, you know, deep dive, maybe find some sort of angle that, you know, maybe flips your opinion of your numbers? It seems like it'd be difficult to do that, especially on some of these loaded cards like a Tuesday or a Saturday, something like that. You just basically bet, you know, what your numbers tell you to bet.
I do look at the numbers a lot, but sometimes you have to take a look at situational spots as well. Like if LSU is playing against some Sisters of the Poor school, and then the next day they're having, or not the next day, but maybe like 2 or 3 days later, they're having to play against like Duke or something like that. That could be a letdown spot. That is always something that you have to take a look at. Coaching also is huge in college basketball. As we do this podcast, Oregon has covered 18 out of their last 20 games against the spread. I think it's no coincidence that Dana Altman, in my opinion, is the best coach in all of college basketball. He makes sure that his team is all geared up and ready to go against these big-time bomber teams, but at the same time, they're not just looking past a school like Hawaii a couple days ago, who they just completely blew the doors off of. And then there are other teams I fade. Now, it hasn't been going well for me fading Leonard Hamilton so far this year, but by and large, he's a guy that he's not necessarily a great in-game coach, made a lot of money on him the last couple years in fading him, might need to adjust a little bit because he seems to be doing a little bit of a better job of in-game coaching so far this year. But that's always something that you have to take a look at. And sometimes there's gut feel as well, because going into the 2019 NCAA tournament, in regards to my power rankings, I had Gonzaga as my number one team. I had Virginia as my number two team. But I felt that if Virginia was able to get to that Final Four, they were going to have a big chip on their shoulder just with the way that the year before they had lost to the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. And I thought that, you know what, this is a team of destiny. They're going to be able to propel themselves to victory. And boom, wouldn't you know it, they wound up being able to win the whole NCAA tournament. Obviously, the Gonzaga versus Virginia matchup didn't quite get there. But despite that, if it would have been Virginia versus Gonzaga, even though I had Gonzaga slightly higher, would have been rolling with Virginia just because of that motivational spot.
Now, here's something I kind of wonder about here. You know, again, like we just talked about, you are coming up with your own numbers. And there are, you know, these formerly the added games or the extra games on the board. You mentioned the Northeast Conference, for example. So I would presume that based on the amount of work you put in, you know, relative to what the odds makers and the bookmakers put in, you know, like you said, they're worried about Duke, North Carolina, Michigan, Oregon, stuff like that. Do you deviate from flat betting in some of those smaller conferences where you feel like you've got a bigger perceived edge, or are you betting, you know, the same amount, whether it's the same unit size or percent of your bankroll on every game?
I always go same amount every single game. I'm not one that double fires or anything like that, because the big thing is you never know when a bad beat is going to happen. It's just one of those situations where you think, yeah, you probably have a bigger edge on this game, but at the same time, if you put yourself down the rabbit hole of thinking, oh, this is a stone cold lead pipe lock of the century, that's when things can really start to go awry. And you never know, you have to make adjustments yourself, because I actually got off to a rough start in college basketball during the 2018-19 season. I wound up having to make some adjustments because I wasn't anticipating as many games going to overtime as actually happened. I was playing a couple, actually too many unders, because typically they always say that there's value in unders, but it's not like unders hit at like a 65% clip or anything like that. You need to balance out overs and unders. So it was a little bit more of a me issue. And you never know when that is going to be the case, because there's always a situation where the bookmakers get ahead of the odds, where the bookmakers get ahead of those that are betting. And there's always a little bit of a situation too, where sometimes the bettors find themselves a little bit ahead of the bookmakers. The big thing is not getting complacent, always evolving, and always making sure to protect yourself, because you never know when the bottom is going to fall out. You're going to get into a little bit of a rough patch. If that's a one patch in which you're playing much bigger than you normally do, that could put you in a little bit of ruin.
Something I'm kind of curious about here. I used to have this talk with Sports Cheat. I know you and I are both familiar with him, Preston Johnson from ESPN's Daily Wager. Very, very sharp handicapper, one of the smartest guys that I've ever known. And he keeps a separate bankroll for each sport. You know, he'll have an amount at the start of the season and kind of roll with that. So my question for you here, Greg, you know, I mean, you've got a massive percentage of your bankroll in play on, say, a college basketball Saturday, something like that. Do you have all of your sports pooled into one giant bankroll, or do you sort of start with, you know, just to make the math easy, start with, you know, 10,000 in college basketball, 10,000 in MLB, and just keep them all separate entities?
I go with the same bankroll on all my sports, just because right now the only thing I'm doing other than college basketball is the NFL, which the NFL, let's face it, that's 16 games a week. That's not necessarily something that's going to be a big damper. And with me, I play a very small percentage of my bankroll in all these games. It's not like I'm firing 3% on all these college basketball games, because by the time I fire on like the first half of the card, it's like, oh, I'm already having my entire bankroll in play. So I'm more of a guy that you always hear like 1% of your bankroll is typically what you should be playing on a game. I go with a third of a percent, so that way I can cover these big Saturdays in which you've got these 100-plus game cards, and that also allows me to be able to put down my bets throughout the week on the NFL as well. So I'm one of those people, I just have one big bankroll, but at the same time, it is pretty much rolled over, I guess you could say, from college basketball to MLB, since the MLB season starts just after college basketball, and college basketball season starts a few days after the MLB. So it's not like I get myself into trouble by having just too many sports in which I'm playing games.
Now, and as I look at your most recent update coming off of last night, a very small college basketball card last night, you are up 91.95 units on the season, up almost 92 units here so far as of December 10th. And first of all, congratulations for that strong start. But as you mentioned, you know, using a third of a percent there, that means a third of a percent as your bankroll escalates, right? So you're betting more now than you were at the start of the year.
I am. What I do with my bankroll is I always try to recalibrate it month by month, because you don't want to be like having to redo your bankroll amount every single day or anything like that, because you're going to have good days, you're going to have bad days, and you're going to have different days in this racket. I mean, it's one of those things where you can't overreact to one great day. You can't underreact to just one thing as well. But at the same time, I find what works best to me is month by month, increasing your bankroll a little bit. If you're increasing your unit size, I should say, with regards to your bankroll, if you're just continuing to win, and if things are a little bit worse, you just dial it back a tad. You just adjust it to where your bankroll is on the first of every month. That's the best way to go about it, in my opinion. So that way you're getting down a little bit more if you're having success. And if things are not going so well, you give yourself a little bit of buffer time to get back to where you were.
I completely agree. You know, as a flat bettor, I think that's the way to do it. Again, and doing it monthly, you know, I mean, with your volume, you know, I think that probably makes a lot of sense too. Maybe for some people, you reevaluate it at the end of the week, you reevaluate it after 2 weeks, something like that. But for our listeners out there that are flat betting, I think that is the best way to do it. Don't just say that your flat bet is $100, because if you lost, you know, 10 more bets than you won last week, well, that's a much larger percentage of your bankroll. So I think it is very important to make those adjustments. Speaking of importance, Greg, what's important for you? What are the stats, you know, the factors, the things that you have in mind, the things that you create your own numbers from? What, you know, what are you looking at the most? What are you weighing the most into your, for lack of a better term, formula?
What I really like to look at is per possession numbers, because with college basketball, different teams play at different paces. You've got Virginia, who's right now taking college basketball back to the dark ages. It is absolutely terrible. They're playing like, I don't know how many possessions per game, but they are dead last in the country in that regard. And then you got these teams like Memphis. They are running up and down the court. They're looking to get 100 on any given day. And you do take a look at just how a team is playing in general. Now that's going to shake things up, because typically you'll find that it is a little bit easier to slow a game down than it is to speed one up. There are some teams that I guess you could call it are a little bit bulletproof to that. If you've noticed, Houston Baptist, a school out there in the Southland, they have been giving up 100 points a game. It doesn't matter who they're playing. I think that they would give up 80 points to Virginia at this point. They just love to run it and run it, and they have no concern at all for defense. They'll give up those easy layups, and they'll try to get points on the other end to no success whatsoever, but that is something that you take a look at. I also take a look at rebound rate, the amount of rebounds that a team is pulling in regards to the amount that are actually available. That is so big, because we noticed in that Illinois versus Maryland game, Illinois was very nearly able to win that game as a double-digit underdog. Why? They've got a bunch of guys in Kofi Cockburn and Georgie Bezvanishvili that are able to hold up on the glass against a guy like a Jalen Smith. And that's a good way of being able to get extra possessions, give yourself extra opportunities, control the game. And then, is there anything worse in college basketball than laying like 5 or 6 points with a team and then having that game be like 5 or 6 with 30 seconds to go, and you bet on a team that has a collective shoot 63% at the free throw line, and here comes 7-footer Mr. No Coordination Whatsoever, 25% free throw shooter, and you need to rely on him making one of those free throws in order for your bet to cash. So I always like to back teams that are good at the free throw line. Rebound rate has been big to me. Obviously, you're taking a look at teams that shoot it well from three, teams that don't give up a lot on defense. And sometimes the matchup is big as well, because sometimes you'll have a narrow advantage slash disadvantage on a power ranking. Sometimes a star player like Marcus Howard can be what pushes you over the top there. But those are some of the things I look at. Never bet on a team that is probably going to be in a close game and just has absolutely atrocious free throw shooting.
Well, and I think that's important too, because obviously, you know, the vast majority of our listeners are not professional bettors. And I try to talk from time to time on this show about finding shortcuts, about making things easier for you, whether it's isolating a situational spot, coming back to it, deciding if you still like the spot, something like that. The nice thing about per possession metrics for you is that they work on both sides and totals. So it almost, you know, it's a multi-purpose type of thing.
Oh, absolutely. I'm right there with you, because like with Virginia, if they're playing umpteen possessions per game, the other team is playing umpteen possessions per game, you get a really fast team and a really slow team. You got to think it's going to be slowed down a little bit more, but at the same time, Virginia is still a team that could get sped up a little bit. We always notice their games against Duke, their totals are typically in like the high 130s, the low 140s, whereas a game against Syracuse, that total is going to be significantly lower. So you're able to take that into account, and with per possession basis and with per possession numbers as well, it is very important to just be able to take a look at the percentage of shots that are coming from 3-point range as well, because there are some teams that they're just going to take a whole bunch of 3-pointers. And if they're going up against a team like a Texas Tech that traditionally does a good job of being able to cut off the arc, that could be an issue as well.
I'm sitting here, I'm scrolling through your Twitter timeline. I'm thinking about how much of a godsend the apps are for you, because trying to put all this stuff in person would be absolutely impossible. But you do post all your plays on Twitter, and you also talk about them in your Hoopin' with Hoops podcast as well. But one of the things that always stands out to me is that you're always looking to either showcase if you've locked in a bet or if you're waiting on a bet, waiting for a target number, waiting for that number to get a little bit better. Obviously, it's a very deep and nuanced question, but Greg, how do you sort of try to figure out where these lines are going to go, in particular with college basketball, where you know, you are playing every game on the card?
The biggest thing for me is that I use live odds software. What that is like your Don Best. I know that Las Vegas Advisor has one, Wager Talk, all these places where you've essentially got a screen and it flashes red whenever you get an immediate line move. If a line moved like 2 to 5 minutes ago, it's in yellow. It's just tracking all those numbers, seeing where the money is coming in. Because I'm not one of those people that's like, oh, we're seeing a reverse line move, I must take the other side. Or we're seeing sharp money coming in here, I must roll with the sharps. Or anything like that, because the biggest concern to me is the handicapping that I do and being able to get the best line as a result of that. I don't care if that line is being moved due to sharp money, public money, money that's coming in from Mars. I don't care who's backing that side with me, against me. The biggest thing is just being able to get that best number possible. And the best way to be able to do so is just by tracking all these live lines and knowing when openers come out, because I think that a lot of times the best number that you're going to get is the first one. If you like what you see sometimes on the opener, you've just got to go out there and grab it. And the biggest thing is just knowing when these openers come out. Like with college basketball, BetOnline is the first place that puts them out. Typically, they're putting them out right around noon. Sometimes on a smaller card, it'll be earlier. Sometimes on a bigger card, it'll be a little bit later. Then from there, you've got other offshores like Five Dimes, places like that that follow up. And out here in Vegas, Westgate is typically the first site that puts them up for college basketball. Typically around 4 o'clock p.m. Pacific has been the norm this year, but I've been noticing that they've been doing a better job of getting them out there faster. So I give them a little bit of kudos there. William Hill typically follows from there. Coast is also the only one, along with the Westgate, that typically puts out an overnight total on college basketball as well. So it's just knowing when these lines are coming out for one, and two, just seeing how the money is moving on some of these. Because if you see a line and you don't like it immediately, and you're seeing that money is coming in on the other side, it's shortening that line, it's making the line a little bit more appealing for you, just continue to hold off a little bit more, and you just wind up firing when you see buyback. And the big key with that is just having a couple different books to choose from. Don't be loyal to just one book. Be loyal to your bankroll, and that'll help you be able to get the best number.
Now, we talk a lot on this show about the difference between betting and handicapping. We've talked a lot about the nuts and bolts of betting here in terms of bankroll management, in terms of market entry, things of that sort. So let's talk about how Greg Peterson handicaps some games here. And I'm sure you'd rather talk Stony Brook and Hofstra or Detroit, Notre Dame, something like that. But I want to look here at Texas Tech and Louisville. In fact, we're going to look at both games in the Jimmy V Classic at Madison Square Garden to finish up this segment with you here, Greg. But sort of walk us through what that handicapping process looks like to you here with a game like Louisville and Texas Tech.
With a game like Louisville, Texas Tech, you need to take into account that, number one, this is a game that's going to be played in Madison Square Garden. This is not a true home game for Louisville. This is not a true home game for Texas Tech, anything like that. This is going to be played on a completely neutral site. And one thing that you will find about these two teams is the fact that Texas Tech, they wound up playing at Madison Square Garden last year. They played against Duke in a game in which they very nearly pulled it out. That was actually the game in which they put themselves on the mat, because they weren't able to knock off Zion Williamson and company, but they were able to hang at bay because so many people were thinking at that time that Duke was completely invincible, and there's Texas Tech holding them down with their defense. So that is a little bit of an interesting parallel. With Louisville, you've got a guy in Jordan Nwora. He's averaging over 20 points per game, shooting 40-some-odd percent from three. But what really impresses me about Louisville is the fact that in that game against Michigan a couple days ago, Steven Enoch, Dwayne Sutton, and Nwora all had 10-plus rebounds in that game. But with Texas Tech, you're noticing that a couple guys are stepping up to the plate with Javree Ramsey being injured a little bit. It's going to be a little bit unclear as to whether you're going to get a full Javree Ramsey, whether you're going to get none at all, or a little bit of a hobbled one. But he's been the team's leading scorer as a freshman with 17.5 points per game. But even behind him, you got guys like Davide Moretti that are shooting over 40% from three. He's one of the big holdovers from that team that wound up making the national championship last year. And you got a coach, Chris Beard, that I think is one of the best in the business. He's going to do a good job of being able to get his players up. And Chris Mack, certainly we know what he's doing at Louisville right now. It is absolutely spectacular. He has taken a program that, let's face it, they were sort of in the dumps. Not sort of in the dumps. They were completely in the dumps. Things were just not going well for this program in general, and he has resurrected it. We saw this line being right around 7 on the opener. As we're doing this podcast, I'm seeing it between 6 and 6.5. I think that Louisville should be able to win this game. I just would be a little bit weary of laying the 7. But I will say that if Texas Tech is sending Ryan McMahon to the free throw line, going to make it easier, because last year in regards to free throw shooting percentage among qualified players, Ryan McMahon was number one in the country at 95%.
Yeah, this is a total that has come down 130.5 to as low as 125. And we know MSG kind of has a reputation as being an under venue in college basketball. So that's probably impacting this line a little bit. I do want to ask you about the other game here tonight in the Jimmy V Classic. Indiana and UConn, a very impressive win for Indiana last week over Florida State. They followed up by getting blown out by Wisconsin by 20 on the road. So how are you sort of viewing the Hoosiers tonight here in this game against UConn?
This is actually a play that I wrote up for the New York Post, and I don't understand why this total has fallen from 143 down to about between 139.5 and 140.5, depending on where you're getting your number. But I think that this is a game where both these teams are going to be able to get to 70 points. I think that a big deciding factor in this game is going to be the fact that UConn has a great player in Christian Vitale. He's able to give the team over 15 points per game. He shoots it well from three. He's able to haul in there a lot of rebounds, but he's only 6'3", and he's the team's leader in rebounds. Meanwhile, with this Indiana squad, you bring in Devontae Green. Ever since he's come back in the fold, he's been shooting 50% from three-point range. Missed the first couple games of the year, but you've got Trace Jackson Davis, who as a freshman has come in and has been absolutely spectacular for this Indiana bunch. He is a guy that is hauling in there right around 8.5 rebounds per game. And what you've got to note about UConn as well is the fact that they're playing with more possessions than they did last year. Last year, they played at a rate of about 72 possessions per year per game. This year, more around 75.2. You can tell that Dan Hurley is looking to push the tempo a little bit more. And then with this Indiana squad, number four in the country with regards to offensive efficiency. And what offensive efficiency is essentially the amount of points that a team is going to score per possession. They've been doing an absolutely tremendous job of being a lot more efficient on the offensive end. So I do like the over for that reason. But I think that the fact that you've just got more general size with Indiana and the fact that they're in the top 15 in the country with regards to two-point shooting percentage against a UConn team that, let's face it, they don't have a lot of ideal size, going to be the difference maker here. So that's why I'm laying the points with Indiana, taking the total over.
Greg Peterson, a wealth of college basketball knowledge, especially on the betting side here, to say the least. How can people check out your work, man? How can people find your podcast and also hear you on VSiN?
The best way to be able to do so is my Twitter feed, @Junior_41. Currently with VSiN, I'm making appearances from Thursday through Sunday. I typically do like the Green Zone during the afternoon during all the NFL games, and then I'm on Betting Across America Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. And then you've also got my podcast. If you're looking for a breakdown on every single college basketball game, every single day, it is called Hoopin' with Hoops. I break down everything from like the Louisville versus Texas Tech game today to like Fordham versus Bryant, which as we're doing this is right now going off a noon p.m. Eastern start. I have no idea how that works, but apparently that's what they're doing here on a Tuesday. But I break down every one of those games on my podcast, Hoopin' with Hoops. You can find it on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, Stitcher, TuneIn, wherever you get your podcasts. And then, as always, the hub for all my information, picks, what have you, @Junior_41 on Twitter.
Yep, make sure you follow Greg, as he mentioned, @GUnit_81 on Twitter. And that Hoopin' with Hoops podcast is phenomenal. You do a great job with that. I don't know how you do it, man. I don't know if you just don't sleep, if your blood type is Red Bull. I have no idea, but in awe of what you're able to do, man. Congratulations on your success so far, and best wishes for more success here throughout the college basketball season.
I appreciate the time, Adam. Thank you so much for having me.